Today, we're finishing up our discussion of audio for video with some talk about post-production. Welcome to Vidiotheque, where every week we help businesses get the most out of their internet marketing efforts. I'm Ian Combs, production director here at Third Planet. Today, we're going to head into the studio to finish up our discussion about audio for video. So, here's our clever segue.
And here we are in our editing software. We're using Adobe Premiere Pro, and I'm just going to use the stock Adobe effect, but this advice will apply in general to most editing software and most plugins. We'll get into plugins once we're done talking about the audio here. First off, I'm going to start by playing the untreated audio from last week's video.
We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green screen to help knock down reflections from the long axis of the room.
Now, you hear that in general, that sounds more or less like what the finished blog sounds like. That said, there are a couple of things I want to address. One, the main one, really, is that the mic we use tends to be a little bright. And that brightness, especially in sibilant frequencies, things like S's, T's, hard K's, and CH's, those sorts of sounds can be pretty offensive if you don't control them properly. So most of the EQ I'm doing here is with that thought in mind, that I'm trying to remove the things that are offensive. So I'm going to open up the EQ, and this is just a stock EQ here in Premiere. And you see I've got three bands enabled. I've got a high-pass filter here at about 50 hertz. That's really more knee-jerk than anything, just to make sure that there's no rumble or, you know, anything else left over from what we recorded. I don't hear a huge change with it. That's more just a safety thing. Probably unnecessary because I've recorded this stuff with an EQ already. But if you're using a lavalier mic or the mic's really close or you're outdoors and there was some wind rumble, that can be a very helpful filter just to make sure that you're not getting the low-end junk that's eating up all your bandwidth and making things impossible to work with. It also can help with control of plosives. If someone pops a P or a B or sometimes even T's, that blast of air that hits the mic, that can create a really big thump. So this filter is really helpful for controlling that. You'll see in this EQ, they call it a cut filter. That's a high-pass filter in more common terms. Sometimes you'll see that abbreviated HPF, and that's what that's for. That's just kind of to control the low end. So you'll see I also have two other cuts. I've got this mid-range cut here at about 200 hertz, 215. What I'm going to do is I'm going to play back that same segment of me talking, and you're going to hear, I'm going to turn it up, and you're going to hear what...
We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green...
Okay, so moving up, my second band, mid one here, 215 hertz. There was a little low mid junk in the room, and I didn't like it, so I pulled a little of it out. What I'm going to do is I'm going to play this back, and I'm going to turn it up. Actually, I'm going to turn it up right now, so you can hear what that junk sounds like and why I removed it.
We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green screen to help knock down reflections from the long axis of the room.
So it's just a little low-mid kind of roomy sort of tone that I wasn't a big fan of, so I took a little of it out. Now, the big one for me in this setup was what I did at mid-three. Mid-three at about 2,800 cycles is right in the most sensitive range of our hearing. The human ear, really between about 2,000 hertz and 4,000 hertz, is at its most sensitive. It's most sensitive to those frequencies. And this is also where some hardness came into this recording. The mic we use can sound a little bright and a little hard, partly due to the fact that it's so directional. So what I did here is I took out a little bit of this, you know, just about 3,000 hertz. And I'll play this back again so you can hear, and I'll do the same thing as I did the last time so you can hear what I'm taking
out. We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green screen.
All right, I'm just going to stop there for a second. You hear how hard and painful that is. So I'm going to back this back down, and you're going to hear that it's a lot gentler on the
to help knock down reflections from the long axis of the room. Now, I can't stress strongly enough.
Okay, now, I feel like I've taken care of a room rumble that I didn't like and some hardness, but the S's and the T's are all still a little more fiery than I'd like them to be. So, I've dialed up a de-esser. Let me open that up. A de-esser is basically a device that allows you to selectively turn down a band of frequencies. You see here this dark green area. That's the band of frequencies that this is actually working on. I've got this set to multiband, which means this compressor, a de-esser is a compressor that's only working in that frequency region. So what we'll do is, you've heard it now without the de-esser. This is the first time I've instantiated the de-esser. It's not on bypass anymore. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to play back the sibilant frequencies, and you'll hear what I'm talking about.
We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green screen to help knock down reflections from the long axis of the room.
You hear how offensive that is. It's really, really uncomfortable. And when you hear that stuff in headphones, it makes your eyes cross. So what I'm going to do is that swath that I just had up is now going to get turned down when it exceeds the threshold of this compressor. So what I'm going to do, back this up again, and we will play it back so you can hear the difference.
We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green screen to help knock down reflections from the long axis of the room.
I'm going to play this back one more time with the de-esser off. I will turn it on halfway through so you can hear what it does.
We also set up some packing blanket sails on stands between the camera and the green screen to help knock down reflections from the long axis of the room.
All right, so we've addressed the low end, we've addressed the hardness, and we've addressed the sibilance. Now, I mentioned earlier that these are the stock plugins in Adobe Premiere, and they work fine, but I feel like they're aftermarket plugins, third-party plugins, that help me do this job better and faster with fewer plugin inserts. There's an EQ plugin that I'm a big fan of called Metric Halo Channel Strip. That's a bigger EQ. It's got more bands. It's got a compressor built in. It's got a limiter built in. It's got a spectrum analyzer so you can see some of these things. That can be a really helpful tool when you're learning how to EQ and learning how to DS and learning how to manipulate audio. And I'm a big fan of that. I think usually it's about $140, something like that, but it's definitely worth checking out. There's also plenty of great plugins from other companies, companies like Waves or Isotope. There's just a bunch out there. It's a big marketplace, and a lot of them work in a lot of the video editors now. So it's worth doing some homework to find a good tool to help you make your audio sound as good as it can.
And that should just about cover it. I realize that this is a rather deep and technical topic that might not necessarily be covered in the greatest of detail in this format. So I'm working on some text blogs that we'll publish in the coming weeks. Keep on the lookout for those. In the meantime, if you like what we're doing, click the subscribe button and share us with your friends. Leave comments below or send us an email at the address on the screen. Thanks for watching. Now get out and do something.